So we're going to talk about emotions in general, what they are, what purpose they serve, why do we feel things like anxiety, worry, love, why do you care about people? What is burnout? Because many of you feel burnt out, depressed. Sometimes people want to know what is the difference between burnout and depression, so we'll cover that. Then we're going to look at stress in particular. When does it cause burnout? In other words, what is the relationship between stress and burnout? How it affects you in particular, or what your sources are? What is a mental illness and where does it come from? That's a little two-slide deviation there. And then how do we cope with our loss of control? So let's start with the question, why do we have emotions? Emotions are calls to action, which is, I think, the simplest way to understand it. An emotion is something you feel. The body determines a problem. It senses something wrong and says, do something. And so it pushes us to do something. When we're hungry, we eat. When we're scared, we run away. And if we didn't have emotions, we wouldn't do anything. So we absolutely need our emotions to survive, even though we don't like them all the time. Just like pain. Very few people like pain. So it's one or two people in every audience that does, but most of us don't like pain. And it's the body's way of saying, listen, you're so uncomfortable, do something, make sure you stop feeling this. So if it's cold in winter, you put your hands under your arms, you blow on them, and so on. And the body says, while you feel me, there's still a problem. So keep doing something until you don't feel me anymore. Which is great, right? If you see a lion in the forest, you're going to run. And if you didn't seem to care, you wouldn't run. So you need to get to safety. So in general, they do that. The thing is, it's fairly easy to understand why we have anxiety. Right? You see a bear in the woods, you're going to run. But it's not so easy to understand why, for example, I remember when I was in Italy when I was a kid, they slaughtered one of the pigs to make, well, to eat. They're on the farm. That's what people do. It doesn't come in styrofoam. And it was a little disturbing to see, but anyway, I watched it. I was 14. And then the little piglet stopped eating. And a few days later, they said, we're going to have to slaughter the piglet, even though she's not grown, and it's too bad because, you know. And so how would you have diagnosed the piglet?
Depressed.
Depressed, right? So it stopped eating. And what happens when you stop eating? You die, right? So how is that a survival instinct? How is depression supposed to help us live? So why do we feel sadness? Why do we feel guilt? Why do we feel love? It causes all kinds of trouble, doesn't it? But we feel there are emotions that are meant for our immediate survival. We have to be scared because if we're trapped in a cave, we could be eaten. So we have to protect ourselves and stay alive. But the species has to survive as well. We have to get together. We have to find a mate. We have to take care of babies. And if we don't do that, we're not here. And so we have social emotions as well, the ones that connect us to others, the ones that make us feel, the ones that make us sad when we lose a loved one. Should we listen to our emotions? Most people say yes. So, if you are scared of the dentist, your emotion's telling you, cancel the appointment. Should you listen to that emotion? Let's suppose you're in the forest, walking with your psychologist. And you run into a bear. What would you do? I give you three choices. Please don't jump to that. Choice number one. You start running as fast as you can because obviously you're in danger, there's a bear, you gotta get the hell out of there. Choice two, you turn and you run towards the bear because all psychologists tell you you should face your fears. Or three, run faster than your psychologist. Make sure you get a fat psychologist. I tell you that because, obviously, we normally should listen to an emotion, right? When we're stressed, we should act. But sometimes an emotion is exaggerated if we're scared of the dentist. Well, that doesn't make a lot of sense. Or if we're so scared of giving a talk in class that we drop our courses and in fact we abandon our studies because we're terrified of that, then listening to your emotion doesn't protect you. All it does is restrict your life, okay? So the reality is that emotions, normally when they're in balance, tell you the right thing. But when they're exaggerated, they control your life and don't necessarily protect you. So the correct answer to this is you should listen to your emotions when they're in balance, and you should resist them when they're too strong and they're controlling your life. Regardless of your challenge in life, whether it's family issues, whether it's work issues, and so on, once in a while feel burnt out, and many people say, well, what is burnout? I don't know. Because burnout isn't a diagnosis, it's a popular term. But here are a few indications of, well, indications that there is an issue going on. Okay? Burnout essentially is best defined as a loss of function. I mean, it was a term coined by researchers who wanted to measure functionality in people who are in the helping profession, nurses and doctors and so on. And then they started noticing that the same issues occur everywhere else, whatever your business happens to be, whatever your job happens to be. And so, in general, they define it as some loss of function. So that's probably the best way of looking at it. When you're not doing what you can normally do, like you don't feel like working when you normally would work, you don't want to see friends anymore, and normally you're very sociable. In other words, there's a drop in functioning in your life. And these are some symptoms that you might feel. For example, you might feel anxiety. Well, we all feel anxiety, but more than normal. Frustration, sense of futility, what's the point, it's useless. A couple of interesting ones here, impatience, and pessimism, and the last one also loss of productivity. You know, there are a lot of people who are impatient. It's a big deal. They're not burnt out, they're just impatient. But if you're not normally impatient and you become impatient, you know, whenever I snap at my wife, she always says, you need a vacation. Maybe you need to stop irritating. But it's true that when you tend to have less tolerance to things, that's probably too much on your plate, and it's a red flag. Same thing with pessimism. A person who's normally upbeat, oh, don't worry about it, it'll work out, all of a sudden it's all gloom and doom. Again, it's a change in their normal pattern, or people normally produce a lot. So if you notice that there's a drop-off, or there's a change in your style, then those are indications that you're on the edge. Okay? And it's very difficult to deal with the problem after the fact. You're better off sort of identifying some of the stressors before they get too bad, because it's very difficult to undo things. It's much easier to prevent things. Okay? We'll talk about that next time. So is it depression? Well, the reality is that many people use the term burnout interchangeably with depression. It's a popular term. Like in the old days, we just used to say nervous breakdown. What does that mean? Well, it can mean anything from the person's in the corner in a fetal position to the person's fed up with their lives. I mean, so burnout generally means that things ain't going well. And so is it really depression? Well, depression is a mood state. There are two main symptoms. You have to have one of these two. It sounds pretty obvious that to be depressed, you have to have a sad mood or depressed mood, right? But that's not always the case. Some people who are depressed just don't feel anything. They have a loss of pleasure in things that normally give them pleasure. Like you hold a baby, you're happy. Even if you're depressed, you might still feel the joy. You're at a funeral parlor and you see a cousin you haven't seen in years. You take them in your arms and you're crying and you're happy and you're feeling strong. But some people, when they're depressed, it's dead. Completely dead inside. And this might happen in some people's families and so on and so forth. So the reality is that to be officially diagnosed, for what it's worth, for an official diagnosis of depression, there are two symptoms and you have to have one of these two. You have to be either depressed or have anhedonia, what it's called, loss of pleasure, or both. And you also have to have a number of other symptoms, not all of these, but these are common symptoms that you see in depression. Sleep problems. Typically what happens when people are depressed is they get up early in the middle of the night and they can't fall asleep again, so they tend to feel worse in the morning. So early morning waking is common. Sometimes people have trouble falling asleep because they're preoccupied. So some sort of sleep disturbance, typically early morning awakening. Trouble concentrating, agitation, fatigue. Recurrent thoughts of suicide or death. You don't necessarily, I mean, you might think about suicide, but you might also say, what's the point of living? Or I don't care if I die, or who cares if I get a diagnosis of whatever. You just don't feel, you're very preoccupied with that. Changes in appetite. Most people say, oh, when I'm depressed, I eat. Or it's an excuse for being overweight. The reality is that while it can happen, I tell you what, I eat because I like to eat. The reality is when people are depressed, they typically lose weight or they lose their appetite. Not all the time, but it's more common that you're going to lose weight than gain weight. Unless you could care less anymore and you're fed up with it and you're just letting yourself go. And of course, feelings of worthlessness. So that's what depression is, right? Depression is the state of mind where you're feeling like this. Oh, by the way, it has to last for at least 2 weeks for an official diagnosis, if you want. And more importantly, it has to have an impact, a strong enough impact on your suffering. Like some people might go to work and they're thinking all day about putting a bullet in their head. And nobody would notice. They're just functioning, saying hi to everyone, making jokes, but you know, inside it's just eating away at them. So here's a person who's suffering tremendously, even though it doesn't show, and even though they're producing normal amounts of work. Whereas another person might be fine. You know, I'm not thinking about anything, I just can't work. I just can't be there. Really has a hard time doing what they normally do. So there has to be a loss of function, or there has to be an impact on your personal suffering. It has to be significant for it to be considered depression. So what's the difference between the two? The simplest way of putting it is that burnout is a circumstance, to me anyway. In other words, you're not functioning like you would normally function. Okay? But it's a little more specific because some people, they're sad, they're depressed, they're freaking out, they can't work because they have a conflict at work or with their boss, or they have a tyrant for a boss. And then I say to them, if tomorrow someone offered you a job that paid the same, with a different person, and you can handle it just as easily as this job, just as complicated, same pay, same conditions, so on and so forth, how would you feel? Oh man, I'd be on top of the world. So depression doesn't turn on and turn off like that. Whereas burnout is more related to circumstances, not always, but generally so. So it can happen when you're depressed. In other words, if you're depressed, you can't function. So you might be calmed. They might say you're on burnout, but the truth is it's more of a depression. It can happen because of work conditions alone, as I just mentioned. Okay? And it's influenced by personality factors, some of the things that we're going to talk about. So if you're a perfectionist, for example, and nothing you do is good enough, you're going to tend to be vulnerable to depression. You're going to be vulnerable to feeling burnt out. If you say yes to everyone, and you do a good job, and you want to please everyone, so you're doing the job of four people, that's also the way you are, right? So your personality contributes to your stress and your load and so on, so it can cause both depression in a broader sense or burnout in a more specific sense at work. Whereas depression, I see it more as a mood state. It's easier to understand it that way. So you're sad. Of course, it can cause burnout. Obviously, if you're depressed, you're not going to be able to function normally. It can be caused by burnout. Here's interesting, because occasionally people feel very responsible for themselves. They feel as if they should be strong, they feel as if they should help others, and they've got so much on their plate, they're cracking, but they don't want to take time off because they feel guilty, and because they feel like only they're worthless if they can't do their job. So then they can't do their job. The doctor says, take some time off. They take time off and they feel horrible.
because they can't function well. In other words, the fact that they can't function at work feeds their depression. And it can be influenced by the same personality factors that cause burnout.
The thing with depression is that it can happen independently of work. I mean, some people get depressed just for biological reasons, it just hits them. Some people get depressed because of problems in their personal lives, even if things are going well at work. So even though there isn't an official definition of burnout, generally we refer to work problems and burnout. And this is broader. So what are the causes of these feelings of fatigue, burnout, depression, sadness? They can be physical. When I say biological, if they discover a tumor in your kidney, it isn't necessarily caused by anything you did, right? It just happens. You develop Parkinson's. I got Parkinson's. I have a neurological problem. You start to forget because you're developing dementia. Again, the problem is in the brain. And you didn't plan this. It's not because of something you did. It's just something that happened. So in some cases, that's what depression is. The problem is that people have a tendency to think, okay, why am I like this? What have I done? And so on and so forth. But the reality is that for some people, it just happens. It's a physical thing. Okay? Not always. It's a small percentage. But it can happen. And you see a lot of this in bipolar disorder. I mean, if you have bipolar disorder in your family, you'll see that circumstances don't necessarily play a huge part. They're doing well, and then boom, they just fall into a deep depression. And then sometimes they start talking faster, having energy, not sleeping as much, not needing very much sleep, and changing topics all the time. A very nice blouse that you got. I know where you got that. Nice store downtown. Downtown, you notice how much they're building downtown? And they go on and on and on. If you're going through a divorce, or you lost your job and you may not be able to pay your mortgage, well, who would not be despondent? Who would not freak out? Does that make you ill? Does that mean you're sick? Well, you're depressed. But you're depressed because of your circumstances. That's completely understandable, right? And of course, psychological. I mentioned before that if you're the kind of person who, every time something goes well, it's because you were lucky. You get a promotion, it's because they didn't have anyone else. You get a compliment, well, they're just being nice. Something, or you get an answer right in a test, oof, I was lucky. Meanwhile, you get an answer wrong on a test, it's because you're an idiot. Even though no one else got the right answer, right? Or they're laying everybody off at work, but no, well, it's because of me. In other words, there are some people, every time something goes well, they tend to blame circumstances, attribute it to the outside, luck, whatever. And whenever things go badly, they find themselves to blame all the time. There are people for whom nothing they do is ever good enough. If you're one of these people, well, you're going to be more prone to feeling depressed. In other words, there are many, many psychological factors that interact with our situations. Two people lose a job. One person might be depressed, one person might not. Same circumstances. But the circumstances are lived through the person and their personality and how they see themselves and so on. Let me ask you this. How many of you have more than one child? Are they the same? And if you don't have more than one child, if you have siblings, are they just like you? How come you notice these differences right away? Sometimes even in the womb, right? Early on, this just has nothing to do with upbringing and whether you screwed up their upbringing and so on. This has to do with the fact that they're very different. And we're born, some are born tall, some short, some have long noses, small noses, crooked noses, big ears, and so on. Well, we also have different folds in our brain. We have different veins, different shape, even my two hands have different veins. And the folds in your brain are different.
And that's where personality is. It's somewhere in there. So the fact is that temperament, you know, children who ask a million questions, children who don't. My son, one of my sons. So what'd you do today? Stuff. That's all I ever got from him. He does stuff. The other one, of course, is anyway, much more curious. And you have some kids who will go through a wall to get to the other side, and others will just stop. You have some who are always happy. Some will seem to be fighting against everything. Right? So we're born with our temperament. We're born with certain genetic predispositions. Plus, you know, we also sometimes, like a woman who goes through a postpartum depression, well, it's a hormonal thing, right? So we have hormonal changes. Sometimes we're taking medication that can affect our mood and so on. So there are a whole host of biological, and I include that innate genetic temperament, I include in that everything you eat and everything you, all of the diseases that can happen in your body, thyroid, so on and so forth, all affect, can affect your mood. And it has, again, nothing to do with your circumstances. You know, two people who lose their father in the same week. One is off on a sick leave for 2 months, and the other one's back at work the next day. What does that mean? I have no idea. Fact is that maybe the quality of the relationship is different. But it doesn't mean that the one who comes back wasn't as close as the one who's depressed. It may have to do with how we feel about our ability to get past the loss. It may have to do with how prepared we were, often with how much we can accept things, and so on. Whether we feel that we can go on without this person's guidance. And of course, we talked about psychological factors. The interesting thing about psychological factors is they can be both a strength and a weakness, depending on the circumstances. So you need a cardiac bypass surgery. You have two doctors to choose from. You got Dr. A, whom I will call Dr. Chicken Skins, because every day he practices his surgical technique on chicken skins. You know, because the consistency of the skin, he practices his stitching. He practices the distance of each stitch to be consistent. He makes sure that the cut is clean, that the distance between the stitch and the cut is uniform, that the tension is perfect, because too tight you can tear the vein, and too loose you could bleed, and so on and so forth. He practices every day. Dr. B is good enough. So who are you going to go see, right? Of course you're going to see Dr. A. Who would you rather live with? So that crazy perfectionist, you know what? You go ahead and build my next Champlain Bridge. I'm good with that. But I rebuild my deck. Except I'd rather have a beer on that deck with Dr. B. So the bottom line is that, you know, when there's a solution to be found, these tenacious people who are very driven, that's their strength. They're the leaders of society. Put them in a circumstance where they can't fix it, where it's beyond their control, and it makes them crazy. That's when they feel helpless and depressed. So a personality trait is not a strength, it's not a weakness, it's a strength or a weakness depending on the circumstance. And we'll talk about that, but that's an important issue, especially when you have someone with mental illness in your family, because the person who is able to look for solutions, the problem solver, the person says problem, solution, great. Except when there's a problem without a solution, they can look a long time and drive them crazy. So change what you can change, accept what you can't. Now, last one's a real bugger. Okay, so what causes burnout? I won't get into too much detail here, but basically there are about five main things that I think are relevant. One is we expect too much of ourselves, because a lot of times it comes from us. Oh, I should make more money. I should go to the gym 3 times a week. I should lose some weight. I should take Spanish lessons. I should practice my guitar more, and so on and so forth. Well, yeah, those are all great things. Oh, I got to do yoga too. I forgot about yoga. I should cook when I was eating out. I should cook more. It's all kinds of pressure that we put on ourselves, right? But there's also pressure that comes from others. If you're working in the healthcare system, it's we're doing more with less. Oh, that's what we're doing this year? As opposed to last year. Gotcha. Okay. We're doing more with less. But you know, I mean, you go to the store and you buy a pair of shoes for $50, right? If you see them in the next store for $40, you're going to say, oh, take them here. Someone will say, no, I'll give you 2 pairs for $40. Okay, go buy them there. You're never going to say, that's not enough. I'm going to give you more money. I don't know too many people do that. But it also works when you're the guys manufacturing the shoes. And someone says, listen, can you make more shoes in an hour? So of course they're going to say, can you do more? So there's no end. Nobody says, that's too much work. Do less. So the pressure doesn't end unless you're able to say, well, here's what I'm going to do, and I'm going to do a good job, and that's that. So there's often no limit to this, what we can think of here. There's also no limit to what others can ask us to do. And if you're doing good, the worst part is that the best employees, the bosses keep asking for more stuff because they do it so well. And then the other employees say, can you help me with this? Okay, sure, no problem. So you end up, there's no end to that, right? You know, when you paint, are you going to paint? Or are you going to go back over it and, oh, there's this, and how many times are you going to do that? Are you going to be super, super careful with the edging or not? Of course, the person who has higher standards does a better job. So it's a good thing. But there's also no limit there, right? At what point do they start to become so demanding on themselves, their standards are impossible to meet, that it becomes certainly a source of stress, right? Of course, the imposter syndrome, pretty well all of us have it. So you're in a class, you're in a meeting, teacher asks a question. You have no idea. And Steve has the answer. Well, he's smarter than me, because I don't know. Then teacher asks another question. And this lady over there has the answer. And I don't. She's smarter than me too. Then they ask me a question. And I happen to know the answer. Oof. But Steve and this lady don't know the answer, so they're thinking, oh my God, he's smarter than us. We do that all the time, because people, they go to meetings, oh, you know, on page 4 of this document, there's a typo over here, and you go, oh my God, I didn't even read the document. Well, welcome to the club, nobody reads the documents. But you think, oh, they're very diligent, or they read something, they understand. They go to a movie and they start analyzing a scene. Oh, Jesus, was I asleep during that scene? But you might have picked up on other things. The fact is that we all say what we know, so the people who hear that only hear that part. We're not telling them what we don't know because we don't know it. Anyway, it's very common. We all have that. And of course, sometimes we're in the wrong position. So the bottom line is that if I have a job that I'm not made for, oftentimes I might think that I'm just no good at anything. Instead of realizing that, no, there's lots of things I can do well. I don't have to do everything well. So sometimes it's just a bad fit and has nothing to do with our abilities. So what is stress? Well, stress is essentially the anxiety response. It's what the body feels when it's challenged. Right? Any kind of challenge. You walk in the woods and you see a bear, you're going to be stressed, right? It's your body saying, do something, you're in danger. So it's what energizes us to defend ourselves. Okay? So any form of challenge to the person is a stress. It can be felt as anxiety when it's acute. Oh my God, there's a bear. Or it could be more chronic, like I've got too much work, I can't catch up, and so on and so forth. I've got, you know, problems with my in-laws, I have problems with my parents, and they need to be placed, and oh my God, and it's just ongoing, right? There are four, sort of a mnemonic that will help you remember what
tends to be more stressful? Novelty?
Anything that's new is stressful. Because you don't know how to deal with it. Right?
If you've done it before, okay, I can master it. You walk into a forest, you know there's no lions or tigers, and there's plenty of water to be found, and there's no predators, there's no cliffs. Fine, you go in there, no danger. But if instead you're in a new place, and you don't know what's in there, you don't know if you're going to get lost, you don't know if there's snakes, spiders, wild animals. And so because it's new, you can't be prepared. So novelty scares people. That's why change scares people. Because we don't know if we have the tools to respond to something if we don't know what the thing is, if we've never faced it before. Same thing with unpredictability. Sometimes you have a situation, you have a boss that's always going to be difficult, or a family member that's always difficult. At some point you learn to cope with that. But if some days are super sweet, and some days they are just nasty, or if you have an animal that's nice most of the time and every once in a while bites a kid, anything that's unpredictable is harder to control, so of course it's scarier. Anything that is threatening. Of course, if you walk into a new forest and suddenly you see a teddy bear, you're not going to care that much, right? I mean, we're only stressed when something is going to matter. I mean, if we're going to get a poor grade in a test, but we don't care because it's not used for anything, then it's not threatening. If the poor grade on the test is going to keep us from getting into the program we want to get into, then it's more threatening, right? So obviously, we're only stressed by something that could harm us in some way. And finally, there's a lack of sense of control. Like if you go into the forest and you say, well, there might be wild animals, I'll bring a rifle with me. But I have a rifle with me, with you. So you're not as stressed because you're not in as much danger. You're more in control of the circumstances. So this is important because control is sort of the antidote to stress, right? To anxiety. If we can handle it, then it's fine. The more control we have, the more we can fix whatever problems arise. The least control we have, the more we're vulnerable to anxiety. Stress is the response to challenges. And so the more responsibilities you have, the more challenges you have, the more stressed you are. Like if I give you a task to do at work, it's 9 o'clock, say, listen, I need a letter written by noon. So you have 3 hours to write a letter. So I think most of us can handle that okay, not too stressed. If on the other hand someone says, listen, we've got a stack of these things, you've got to do 10 letters before noon. And they all have to be different. All of a sudden, even a very competent person becomes stressed. In other words, the more on your plate, this is how much stuff you have on your plate. The more you have on your plate, the more likely you are to be overly stressed, right? So it increases with this, but it decreases with how well we can handle them. In other words, these are the challenges, and this is the mastery over the challenges. So if you are confident in your ability to write, and you have a letter to write, no problem. But even that one letter, if you're one of these people who writes a letter, goes, oh my God, I don't know how to write a sentence, and they write it, rewrite it, and cross it out, put it in red, and then crumple it up and throw it out and start another letter, and so on and so forth, even that one letter becomes stressful to that person. The more able they are to handle the challenge, the less stress they feel. The less able they are, the more stress they feel to fewer challenges. In other words, you have how many challenges you have and how well you can manage them. Which, what that means is that we can all crack. We can all crack because even if you're super good at doing things, but you have too much on your plate, you're going to have a hard time. And if you can't handle anything, it doesn't matter how many responsibilities you have, you're going to have a hard time. Okay? So stress increases with the challenges we have, and it decreases with our ability to respond to those challenges. So no two people react the same way to a similar stressor. The stress response is an interaction between the challenges itself and the individual's perception of his or her ability to respond to it. And this is important because
If we go back to the previous slide, if you are lousy at writing, but you just don't care, or you're not even aware of it, the letter is not going to be stressful. Another person who actually writes well, but doesn't think she does, then they're more stressed by that challenge. In other words, stress increases when our challenges increase, or when we perceive them that way. And stress decreases when we have the tools or the means to respond to them, or when we think we do. So let me start putting some of these things together. Here's what I mentioned about stress, right? Number of responsibilities, you increase your stress. The better you handle them, the less you feel stress. So we have internally generated pressures. I should learn another language, I should make more money, I should do yoga, I can go to the gym 3 times a week, and so on and so forth. Well, in other words, this is a pile. It just keeps adding on to the pile. And if you don't recognize your own limits, if you don't say, well, although I'd like to do that, I don't have the energy or the time, well, then there's no stopping this. The pile just gets higher and higher and higher. Right? In other words, this is the gas. This is the brakes. Without brakes, you're going to crash. Right? Also, boss is asking you for this, your mom's calling you for that, your kid's saying, can you pick me up at the Bonaventure or whatever? Can you write me a check for my tuition? Sure, I just got the money. And if you can't say no, you're calling, can you help me with this presentation? Can you do this for me? Can you do this for tomorrow? Sure, no problem, sure, no problem, sure. Can you give me a ride tomorrow? My car is busted. Sure, I'll pick you up. And so on and so forth. It's all good, right? But at some point, if you can't limit this, there's very few people who are going to stop asking you stuff, especially when you're good at it. And so this is going to keep piling on. And these are the brakes. So you have gas coming from inside, you have gas coming from outside, and either you've got to stop it yourself by recognizing your limits, or you have to be able to say no to people or set limits. Otherwise, there is no limit to this. This will keep increasing and increasing and increasing. And we want to take care of our loved ones. And when you have one of them that's having a hard time, there is no end to what they can ask of you and what they need of you. There's nothing wrong with wanting to help. If you don't have some skills, let's say you're missing some skills, if you don't have support from siblings, from your husband or wife or your ex-husband or ex-wife, then, of course, it's going to be harder to manage the same stressors than another person, right? So lack of support makes this tougher, reduces this ability. Lack of confidence in yourself makes it harder to handle the same challenges. The perfectionism, the high standards, when you expect things done super well and you push and take a long time to do your letter and so on and so forth, then the same challenges are harder to handle. In other words, these are the things that increase your responsibilities, and these are the things that make it harder to manage them. So now I want you to take a good look at this slide and ask yourself where you see yourself in. How many people here feel overly stressed? The rest of you are lying. Maybe not. But the bottom line is that when we're feeling like, ooh, this is a lot, sometimes we don't have much of a choice. Mm-hmm. It's not as if we can, if we have physical illnesses, either in ourselves or our family members, these come from the outside. We can't say no to that. Mm-hmm. We can't say no, thank you. So sometimes this is going to be tough no matter who you are. Okay? But more often than not, you do contribute somewhat to it. You contribute by probably wanting to fix everything, or by questioning what you are doing wrong, or by not having support at somewhere, either with colleagues, with family members, and so on and so forth. Right? Or maybe it's because you say yes to everyone, no matter what, no matter who asks you, you want to please everyone, so this becomes a big problem. So if you look at this, you'll sort of have a better idea
where you stand and what are your sources of stress.
I'll give you this example. You know those little Italian coffees there?
Espresso.
Yeah. That. What do you call that? I had a guy come to my office. His manager was worried about him because he was expressing suicidal thoughts and, can you see him? He was an employee at the hospital, and I said, sure, have him come see me and I'll talk to him. He wasn't a real client. What that means is I didn't have a file, I didn't write his name on a dossier, whatever. I just didn't come on in, we chatted for a little bit, and he's telling me about how much of a loser he is. You know, I'm just a cleaner. Nobody knows my name. I walk down the hall, nobody knows me. Well, first of all, I was a cleaner once. Nobody knows my name now. I'm a psychologist. Doesn't seem to make a difference. But anyway, and he's telling me, well, I never went to university, blah, blah, blah. And even though he has 3 kids, he's married, he's a coach, and people like him, so on and so forth. He's a good guy, but, you know, he thinks he's stupid. He says, even my brother thinks I'm stupid. I said, why do you say that? He says, well, I asked him for an espresso, and he tells me it's espresso. That's the story. Except that the guy used that as proof that he was an idiot. What if you ask someone for an espresso and they correct you and say it's espresso? How would you feel? Well, you might say, oh, I didn't know. Or I can explain to you, there's no X in the Italian alphabet. It's an Italian word. There's no Y, by the way. There's no G. There's no J. So Giuseppe is spelled with a G. And Giovanna. And Yolanda is I-O-L. And espresso means quick. It's E-S. All right. Okay. Or you could say, who gives a rat's ass? Half the world says espresso. Including most Italians, by the way. Because Italians translate the word into espresso fast. One guy, at the same time, an Italian client of mine, had a sandwich shop. And what I was asking, hey, come to my shop, I'll make you a nice espresso. So you can take it as irrelevant, who cares, you know, language evolves anyway, at some point it'll be accepted. And it'll stop being underlined in red in your Word document. Or you can say, man, this guy's such a snob, right? Mm-hmm. Or you can say, oh my God, I'm such an idiot. So what's the correct interpretation? There really isn't a correct one, is there? The fact is, it's an event. Most of us are going along, it's not even a blip on our radar. You know, give me an espresso, whatever, give me a coffee. It's all back. This guy, it hit him in the guts like a ton of bricks. Because he believed he was a failure. And therefore, his only interpretation was, I'm such an idiot. And that's what we call a core belief. It's a fundamental belief about who you are. And a depressed person, it isn't about stuff happening in his life necessarily. It's about how he sees himself. And when you're depressed and you don't have self-esteem, you find proof. This guy found proof. Because he was looking for it. The same guy, by the way, I see him in the park. I saw him 4 times. Okay? 4 times. As I said, not a real client. Means I didn't have a file on him. I didn't write his name on a dossier, write his name on a progress note, take the file out of alphabet order, put it back in, and so on and so forth. I just scribbled his name in my agenda. And you notice he kept saying, nobody even knows my name, blah, blah, blah. I meet him in a park. 2 years later, we're chatting. Hey, how's it going, blah, blah, blah. After 5 minutes, he looks me in the eye and says,
do you remember my name?
Who does that? I swear to you, I regularly forget the name of my own children. Through some miracle of planetary alignment or quantum mechanics, I don't know what, I happen to remember his name. Again, end of story. Yeah, you're so-and-so. So he went off his merry way. What does he think? Well, of course, my psychologist. What if I had forgotten his name? Even my goddamn shrink forgot my name. I tell you that story because it's a perfect illustration of what we call selective attention. You know, no matter what your belief is, any prejudice, all men are pigs.
Is that true?
You know, you can be treated kindly and respectfully by 50 men in a day, and then one guy at a construction site whistles at you, goddamn men, they're all pigs. But it works like that with whatever it is, whether it's religion, whether it's race, whether it's language, gender, whatever, we all see that. We see how people can be so dismissive of something that doesn't fit their theory, and so, see, I knew it when something does. We do that all the time. Why am I telling you this story? Because it also happens to work against us. When we're depressed, we have a tendency to believe something. For example, the imposter believes, well, I'm an idiot. And when he gets a question right, well, it's because it was an easy question. When he gets it wrong, it's because he's an idiot. And so that feeds the mood. Now, if you deal with depressed loved ones or you yourselves have struggled with that, usually it's not always a biochemical thing. Sometimes it's the way you see yourself. And therapy looks at those filters and looks at those biases. Because unless you're aware of the bias, you don't know why you're like this. So you have to start questioning and thinking more critically, okay, maybe it's true, but maybe it isn't. And let's look at the evidence and so on and so forth. Let's take another example. In a class, you've got two students, right? Two students, and both are considered equally smart. They both have the same grades. Let's say you're two students, you're in the same program. Everyone thinks you guys are both top-notch. And pretty well everyone agrees, except you have confidence and you don't. Okay? So I ask you both a question. And let's suppose neither of you knows the answer. How does Miss Confident in herself take that? Well, I guess I don't know that. Tough question now. How does the one without confidence take that? Now I ask a second question. They both happen to know the answer. So Miss Confidence.
Yes.
I'm so smart. Miss No Confidence says, ooh, thank God. And you recognize people like that, right? You may recognize yourselves in that example. The fact is that that just feeds itself. The depression feeds itself. Over time, you'll notice things that fit or don't fit. And that's what we call core beliefs. Schema, or a core belief, is a fundamental belief of who you are. And that feeds a depression, that feeds also the stress that you're feeling, whether you are responsible or not for something, and whether it's your fault all the time or someone else's fault all the time. A person who blames the world for everything that goes wrong is always angry. Person blames themselves every time something goes wrong, is always depressed, and so on. Perfectionism is a real problem when it comes to stress because, as I said before, the way you handle something is going to reduce your stress. But the more you have high standards, the harder it is to handle things according to your standards. So nothing can be completely mastered, health in particular, knowledge. No matter what, no matter how smart you are, there's going to be stuff you're missing. Your own image, what people think of you. Risk when you're driving, there's no guarantee, right?
without the ability to tolerate a certain degree of imperfection or uncertainty, life becomes threatening. And threat, if you recall, is what gives us anxiety and stress. What we need to do, well, what we need to realize, sorry, is that people who think in absolutes, black and white, all or none, the ones who just can't let go, none of the perfect word for it. But if there was one pill I had, if there existed a pill, Aristotle's make this joke. He said, if there was a pill of self-confidence, I'd probably be out of business. I might see the occasional narcissist. But that wouldn't be enough to sustain my practice. But in fact, I don't think that's what people need. If there was one thing we can change, one pill we can have, or one magic technique to do one thing in people, it would be the ability to let go. Because sometimes, especially when you're confronted with a loved one with an illness, and there's only so much you can do, sometimes you've got to be able to just let it be. Or, you know, anxiety is a perfect example. Anxiety is something that, you know, I mean, you don't make yourself fall asleep, right? It just happens. If you try to make yourself fall asleep, it won't happen. If I say I'll give you $10 million to fall asleep in the next 1 million, fall asleep in the next 10 minutes, you won't be able to. Because you can't make yourself sleep. You have to let yourself sleep. Same thing with anxiety. Anxiety is not something you can control. You let it go and it passes. It passes very quickly if you can let it go. And so ultimately, the ability to let go, especially when there's something that's beyond your control, is important. And those who can't, those who want to fix everything, those who say, "What? I need an action plan, what's the next step," and so on and so forth, that's great when there's a solution to be found. When there's no solution to be found, it just feeds this stressor. We must learn to control our sense of control. If you want to prevent bad things from happening, and who doesn't, we must A, know what they are, and B, know how to handle them. To make sure nothing bad happens, you've got to know all the things that can happen, and you have to have an answer to all of them. You have to have a tool. You go back to the stress formula, whatever comes on my plate, I know how to take care of it. No matter what, I have the time to take care of it. Perfect. That'd be great, wouldn't it? So if I can control myself and other people and all the circumstances around me, then all will be good. And isn't this what we all want? Right? And it is a natural tendency. Remember the first slide, talking about emotion. Why do we have emotions? Emotions tell us there's something wrong. Fix it. So of course, the natural tendency is to fix things, to address things. In other words, take control. Control is the antidote for anxiety. There's a problem, I got the answer. Unfortunately, sometimes it works against us. So let me tell you how then you need to manage doubt. And the analogy I use is Batman's belt. Batman somehow had a tool for everything. Right? No matter what the circumstances, he's got a smoke bomb, boom. He's got wires, he can climb up a building while the guy's ironing his pants. Right? Remember that? So how do we think of all these things? Let's go back to this natural environment. I mean, we evolved our emotions in a natural environment. And if you think about what's stressful, if I'm going into a new forest, as an animal, I need to be stressed. I need to be apprehensive because things can happen. So I'm walking into the forest. What can happen in the forest? Well, I run into a bear. Okay, you know, I better bring a rifle. I better bring a gun. So now if I run into a bear, I'm more protected. Ooh. What else can happen? I can see a snake. Okay, I better bring a knife, wear thick clothes, wear, you know, leather boots so I can't get bit, and so on and so forth. you know, it could be a spider, I better wear like protective netting and so on and so forth. I better bring extra water in case I run out of water. As I said, I bring a compass in case I get lost, or at least a bunch of popcorn, I can, you know, make a trail of popcorn. So you start thinking about all the things that can go wrong. What can go wrong? Oh, that can go wrong. Well, then I'll do this. Okay. So you anticipate problems. I'm going to go see the boss. Oh my God, I'm going to go see the boss. I better prepare this. I better do this. I'm going to a meeting. I better read the documents. I better read page 4, see if there's any typos. Right? Going to the doctor. I better lose weight before I see the doctor. Why do we do that? I should, before I see the doctor, I should eat poutine. Because I want to know what it's like, what my body is like when I eat normally. sorry, I digress, as I sometimes do. In other words, this is healthy. By anticipating problems, what can be on the exam, I start preparing the right answers. So the more you anticipate problems, the more prepared you are. So it's a natural protective mechanism that's necessary to be able to do that. However, the problem is at some point, okay, I got a rifle. Well, what if the rifle jams? I better bring a second one just in case. And I don't know how long I'll be there, so what if a branch falls on me? I better bring a chainsaw. In other words, at some point you can't anticipate everything. Because you're not going to function, you're not going to go out there. So ultimately you have to say, okay, I've taken care of the big things. And the same thing works with cars, or with health, or whatever. Well, I'll go to the doctor, I'll take medicine, I'll eat well, I'll exercise. So I'll reduce the risks, but you're not going to get rid of the risks. Mm-hmm. I'll make sure my car is maintained, I make sure I have winter tires in winter, I'll try not to drive too fast, I'll slow down when it's slippery, except when I'm late for a conference. but ultimately, there's still going to be stuff that you can't anticipate. And if you want to try and anticipate all of those things, you're stuck thinking and you can't act. At some point, you have to get into the forest, right? So I can control each worrisome stressor as long as I know what it is and I have the tool to overcome it. But what do I do with the remaining doubt, with the remaining uncertainty? The stuff that's beyond your control. You need two tools. You got to be able to go into the forest and say, well, there might be some unforeseen circumstances, but I'll have to deal with it. You know, you have to have some ability, some faith in your ability to deal with unforeseen circumstances. Like if there's an earthquake, oh, I didn't plan for that one. And now let's see if I can move. Okay, can I move this limb? Can I do this? Can I do that? And in other words, you do have the ability to overcome problems that you didn't anticipate. You need to have confidence in the ability to deal with all the stuff that you haven't been able to plan for. Right? In other words, plan for all the obvious things, put in place a mechanism, bring a tool, prepare yourself for those things. And the stuff that you can't anticipate, stop racking your brain over all the things that could happen. Just say to yourself, well, look, you know what? I've managed things in the past that I didn't anticipate, so I have those abilities. In other words, whatever happens, I'll probably survive. Confidence is your penultimate tool. So what's the last tool? Remember I said, whatever happens, I'll probably survive. But possibly, I won't. In other words, sometimes bad things are going to happen, no matter what. So we have to sometimes be able to accept, right? Accept that some things are beyond our control. I'm going to take 2 minutes to talk about mental illness. Because many people question, where does it come from, what did I do wrong, especially if it's someone in your family who's mentally ill. Let's take 3 gentlemen. Let's take Joe. Joe eats well. He eats nothing but alfalfa and squash and granola. Somehow he has bad arteries. He has coronary artery disease. Then you have Bob. Bob eats poutine for breakfast, and smoked meat at lunch, and ribs for supper. Somehow his arteries are clean. There is no justice in the world.
Meanwhile, Bill eats like Bob, but because of that, he has a coronary artery disease. So you look at this example. What's just interesting is this, in this example, is that this guy is going to be sick regardless of his lifestyle. This guy is not going to be sick regardless of his lifestyle. And this one is going to be sick because of his lifestyle, but not just because of his lifestyle, because there's a vulnerability there. So where's the problem? Is it the genetic predisposition? Well, in the case of Joe, yes. Is it the environment? Well, in this case, no. In this case, well, yeah, to a certain extent. In other words, there's an interaction between the personal vulnerability and the circumstances that bring out that vulnerability. And you see this a lot in schizophrenia. You see this also in other conditions. Let's take schizophrenia for a second. I'm sure many of you are dealing with that in your families. Do you know that if you have a parent, or if you don't have parents with schizophrenia, your chance of developing the illness is about 1%. If you have one parent with the illness, your chance is about 10%. Which is high, but it's also 90% likely that you're not going to be struck with the illness. What's interesting is twins. If you have one fraternal twin with the illness, the concordance rate, in other words, the probability that the other twin has the illness is what? No? 10%. Fraternal twins, dizygotic. Right? In other words, the chance is the same as having a member in your immediate family. But in monozygotic twins, identical twins, if one has it, the chance the other one has it is between 40 and 70%. But it's not 100%. So what's going on? There's something else. And it's not necessarily, we think, oh, it must be environment. Not necessarily. It could be a virus. It could be a flu. There's other theories as well. It could be something in the food you eat, something of that nature. But the bottom line is there is a very strong genetic predisposition. And there's often also a vulnerability. And that this applies to almost every diagnosis in the mental illness spectrum, if you will. Okay? So not everyone manifests the illness the same way. And it's important to understand that, that there's an interaction between the two. But because there's an interaction, people have a tendency to say, well, it must be the upbringing. And that's not the case. Okay? So where does it come from? Let's suppose I open my briefcase and I take out a snake. And I'm going to let the snake crawl in between your legs. And, you know, we'll give it time to go through the whole room. Who would be uncomfortable with that?
I would
say,
I don't know.
Okay.
Out the door.
Okay, instead, I'll take out a tarantula. And I'll put the tarantula on your shoulder. We'll each take our turn. The tarantula on your shoulder. You'd be uncomfortable with that?
Yeah.
Bunch of lips. I'd be gone too, by the way. Okay. Let me ask you to do this thing. Imagine that there's a cake in the oven, and I ask you to take it out of the oven. And I'll give you other things. How many people would be uncomfortable with that?
Nobody.
Okay, so in your lives now, how many people were bitten by venomous snakes? Venomous spiders? Anybody got burnt on the stove, taken out a cake at some point? So how come I'm afraid of elevators? Maybe I was traumatized as a kid. Or maybe all animals in an enclosed space freak out. In other words, we evolved fears that we needed to have to survive when we were in a natural world. So we have a tendency to really not emphasize enough the role that instinct plays. I mentioned innate temperament. Brothers are very different. So this is instinct. This is individual differences from one person to another. You can have one kid with a serious problem and one without. You didn't do anything different to either of them. It's just the way they are.
So this is the way human beings are, and this is the way each human being is different from each other. You know, there used to be a term called refrigerator moms, which is a cruel, cruel term.
Yeah.
Because mothers who would have autistic children, was because they're so unemotional that their kids are detached from them. It's a sick interpretation. In fact, there was one guy with that crazy theory, and somehow it became popular. And so the tendency was to blame the upbringing for mental illness, whatever it was, especially these. It's a neurological developmental disorder. It's a brain problem. Some kids are deaf, some people are blind, and some kids don't have the ability to imagine another person's thinking. So they'll develop Asperger's or autism or something. This has nothing to do with upbringing. Mm-hmm. And when you have like five kids in a family, look at the Marsalis family, the Wynton Marsalis. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got these brilliant musicians, and one's a producer, trombonist, one's a great saxophonist, one's a trumpeter, one's a drummer. The drummer is a little bit odd, but he drums well, and he talks, and so on and so forth. You may have a little bit of autism, a little bit of Asperger's. And the other one is basically non-communicative, serious autism. Same family, right? So it really doesn't come from upbringing, so stop blaming yourselves for it. Good upbringing doesn't prevent mental illness. Bad upbringing can create mental illness. What I mean by that is that if you went through the Holocaust or a war or something like that, you're going to be affected. And you're going to suffer tremendously. But you won't develop bipolar disorder, you won't develop schizophrenia, because that's not caused by that. You'll develop psychological problems, if you will. You might be depressed, you might have flashbacks, post-traumatic stress, and so on and so forth. So the fact is that abuse can screw up kids, neglect can screw up kids, but a good, normal, loving family, all it will do is bring out the best that they can produce, whatever's best for them. But that person might still have an illness, regardless of that. So it doesn't protect them from it. All it does is it makes sure that you at least try to maximize their potential. So I want to talk about that, because I know that for you guys, especially when you have some serious problems in your family, you're dealing with all this stuff, one of the problems with mental illness is that it always comes with a stigma, comes with a judgment. And to say, well, my son is like this, or my daughter's like that, or, you know, my kid's in an institute, or it's still difficult to say. I mean, if someone said, listen, my kid has leukemia, everyone would rally around you. Everyone. But my kid, you know, is on the streets begging for money because he refuses to take medication. So we're not at that point yet of being able to say these things normally, because the tendency is still to feel as if you might be judged. And people still do that. So it's important to understand that these factors, you know, unless you are beating up your kid every day, or that kind of stuff, then it doesn't come from that. When you're not happy with something, what can you do? I mean, let's suppose you get separated from your boyfriend, girlfriend, spouse, and then after a couple of months you say, oh, we should try and get together again. Okay? If it didn't work before, for it to work now, something has to be different. If you're burnt out at work, or burnt out dealing with family problems, or whatever it happens to be, and you stop functioning normally, and after a while you take a break and you feel your energy back, well, why would it work the second time? It's not going to, unless something changes. In other words, you have to start by making a change of some sort. Something has to be different. And without something being different, obviously you'll expect the same results. So what can be different? One thing is personality. For example, if you say yes too often, you might need to say, let me get back to you and I'll think about it. And then, you know, the person might figure out their answer on their own. Sometimes biochemistry. Sometimes it's fix your thyroid or take antidepressant medication, which helps you let go sometimes. Could be your circumstances, you renegotiate circumstances at work, you sort of work out a deal with your siblings so that they'll help you with your parents, or it could be attitude, you know, the letting go or accepting. A couple sometimes, they clash all the time, and I say, well, you know what, you can either eliminate the differences and agree on everything, or one person can make all the changes, or you can make all the changes, or you both make half the changes, or you make some changes, and then you accept each other as you are. Bottom line is that you have sometimes a situation that you don't like. And this could be either there's an illness in yourself, an illness in a loved one, it could be problems at work, anything at all that's just eating away at you, burning you out, stressing you. What are your options? Well, let's suppose that, well, my husband or my wife drinks, it's making me crazy, and my salary sucks. Well, you can change it. You can ask for a raise. You get the raise, great, problem solved. You say to your husband, honey, you need to stop drinking. Yeah, you're right. Stop drinking. Problem solved. Isn't it great? Whatever happens to be the case. Or, you know, I have this ache somewhere, I go to the doctor says, here, have this operation, take this pill, you take it, boom, problem solved. In other words, that should be the first step. Whenever there's a problem, try to fix the problem. Very simple, right? What if you ask for the raise and, well, sorry, we got no money, or it's a union position and the scale and blah, 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 or it's a mom and pop shop and they say, A, we don't have the money, and B, you're not worth it. Whatever. So you're not going to get the raise. You say to your wife, your husband, you got to stop drinking. Yeah, I don't have a problem. Or you've told them 1,000 times you're not going to stop. So now all of a sudden, that option's out. Now what? What are you left with? Well, you can accept it. You know, salary's not great, but it's 2 minutes from my home. I love the people I work with. It's not stressful. I can still pay my bills. Let it go. Accept it. Stop torturing yourself. Really, really accept it. Do an analysis of the pros and cons. If the pros outweigh the cons, let it be. But let's suppose that it just makes you crazy and you can't let it go. Or you do your analysis about your salary and you say, well, yeah, it's true, it's not far from my home, it's not very stressful, and I love the people I work with, but I can't pay my bills, I have no choice. And you can't accept it. Then what's left? Well, you may have to walk away. You may have to say it's time to look for a new job, or it's time to end the relationship. And it's not a pleasant thing, but sometimes that's the only option that's left. And I tell you this because I haven't been able to come up with a fourth option. So you try to change things for the better. You try to live with the things that you can't fix. And sometimes you've got to have the nerve to walk away. Now, what's interesting about this is that you don't always have those options. Someone says, you know, I can't stand my husband's drinking. Okay. Can you get him to stop? Oh, I've tried everything. He has no interest in stopping. Okay. Can you live with it? Oh, it makes me goddamn crazy. I can't live with it. Can you leave? Well, who's going to want me? I got kids. I can't live alone. Blah, blah, blah. Okay. Can you stop him? No, he's not going to stop drinking. Can you live with it? No, I can't live with it. Walk away? No, I can't walk away. No, I can't change it. No, right? How many people find themselves in that circumstance? A lot. Right? So the bottom line is there ain't no fourth option. At some point, you have to commit to something. You either have to do what you can to fix it, or say, that's out. I either have to live with it really and stop torturing yourself, or I have to face my fears and make the changes. Okay? Except that sometimes it is not even up to us. Sometimes we don't have a choice. Doctor gives you a diagnosis of cancer. You can't say, I reject your diagnosis. So you can't say, no, I'm walking away from this, because it's in you. So that's out. Well, obviously, is it treatable? If it is, you follow the treatment. So you can change the outcome. So that option's the best one in most cases, right? So you can't, in that case of a diagnosis like that, you can't reject it. So you change it. What if the doctor says it's not a treatable form? Well, you can't reject it. You can't fix it. The only option left in that circumstance is to accept it. And accepting something does not mean liking something. It's an important thing to remember. Sometimes, and again, we're dealing with different circumstances. You're dealing with someone in your family with a mental illness. Can't reject it. And you do everything you can to fix it and to help it. But ultimately, all you're left with sometimes is saying, well, this is something I can't do anything about other than accept. And people don't want to accept it. And I don't either. Nobody does. Accepting something doesn't mean liking something. It just means recognizing that that's what it is.